The East African tradition of the Maasai tribe is to greet one another with the words Kasirian Ngera, which is Swahili for, so how are the children? In that community, the well-being of their children is the highest priority. If you are interested in participating in thought-provoking conversations about the well-being of children and families, please tune in every Wednesday at 3 p.m. to Fresh Start Today on 860 AM WNOV. Together, we can save our children.
Good afternoon. You're listening to the Fresh Start Today show with Jermaine Reed, Dr. Ramell Smith. The blacksmith is in the studio. Sean Roby is sliding in his chair right now. We have Mr. Keon Jackson Malone behind the mixing board. We're looking to have a great, great show today, talking about the attitude of gratitude. What a powerful topic to discuss on this afternoon. And if you would like to participate in that conversation, you can call us at 414-444-5250. 414-444-5250. Most of you all are already aware that November is National Adoption Month. So I'm not sure exactly who all have gotten adopted this month, but I know we have several kids in our foster care program. And so it's a beautiful thing. You know, it can be a beautiful thing. And so we're happy about that. Dr. Smith, you have an announcement, the new Jubilee Children's Color of, no, Children's Choir of Milwaukee. What's that all about?
Yeah, you know what? And I'm telling you, my daughter's been a part of this since she was four. She's 12 now. And it's just one of those kind of interfaith disciplines that happen over at St. Matthew. But what's so beautiful about it is you have Dr. Wallace Cheatham. Anybody who know anything about music in the city know that this man is classically trained, very gifted. He comes over and he teaches the kids all types of songs. You know, you got some old Negro spiritual hymns. Then you got some classical classical Christmas music. But he changes every year. And I'm always thinking, like, this is way too advanced for the children. And they get it every year. And I'm saying we got babies in there 6, 7, 8 years old. So Dr. Cheatham, Dr. Williams, Miss Murphy, Miss Baldwin, Miss Suggs, they just do a wonderful job with the children over there. And the event is December 2nd, 2016, over at St. Matthew Christian Church. And I say this not only for people to be able to come and to, you know, participate to give our babies some love, but it's something to bring your children to participate in, because it's one of those things, like I said, they usually start like in September, and it's from September to December. So for those 4 months, every Friday from 6 to 7, they had this great, great a choir rehearsal, but it's just a time to meet a lot of different people from different congregations that you may never met, to have some sustained friendships. But I just love to see the children get together, and we talk about, you know, what is this season is really about. This is when we get a chance to really feel that love. We get to see the togetherness, seeing a multicultural, multiracial staff come together, and just to remember what this whole season is about. So it's like one of those things that I just like to invite the community to come see again December 2nd at 7 p.m. at St. Matthew, New Jubilee Children's Choir, Milwaukee. It's always a beautiful event, always.
Sounds like a beautiful event. And so that's going to be on December the 2nd, which is next Friday.
Next Friday.
7 p.m. And where that's located, 2944 North 9th Street. St. Matthew Christian Methodist Episcopal Church. That's a long name, St. Matthew Christian Methodist Episcopal Church.
Hey, you know we got some names.
Yeah, we do. But that's all right. So it should be a good festive event.
Yes,
and
it's going to be a beautiful event as always.
All right. So, you know what? Also, this is National Caregiver Month. So, you know, caregiving is a very important role that we have always had in our culture and our tradition,
Sir.
Looking out for family members, extended family members. Long before there was a traditional foster care system, we had a system that was formal to us.
Ubuntu,
you know,
that's right.
Ubuntu. Now, what does Ubuntu mean?
Well, you know what? It goes back, if you look into South African culture, specifically with Bishop Desmond Tutu, and you look at Nelson Mandela, it's all about the meaning of we. You know, when you look in cultures like this, it's whenever somebody talks about I or individual success, it's looked upon as foreign, as weird, because how can there actually be individual success without the success of we? And so going to your point,
if
one person is down, it just makes sense for everybody else to pull that person
That's
up.
Right.
It was not like a person failed. So when we talk about foster care, it's like we take care of our own. It ain't no foster care. These are all our children. So just the way I take care of my biological children, I have that same type of need, that same type of urgency to take care of any kid I see that's within our village or community. And that's the spirit we need to get back to.
All right. Sounds great. And Fresh Start is still promoting our Black Homes for Black Children recruitment campaign. So if you are interested in taking care of an African-American child, a black child, who needs love, acceptance, a place to call home, a place to call community. We started looking for people who are culturally sensitive and responsive to their unique set of needs, and you can call 414-351-1100, 414-351-1100. We also are looking for a treatment foster care social worker, and you have to be certified or licensed as a social worker in the state of Wisconsin. You can give us a call. Start the new year off right with Fresh Start, 414-351-1100. I like that slogan. Start the new year out right with Fresh Start. That's what I'm talking about. You know, I should be into marketing and branding or something. Start the year out right. So, yeah, we're going to get into this conversation about the attitude of gratitude. So, Dr. Smith, with everything that's going on in the world and stuff is happening, you know, post the election, in response to the election, you know, and the election has impacted the lives of individuals across the age spectrum, you know, young folks and senior citizens. You know, how can folks in this season, in this climate, adopt an attitude of gratitude?
You know, we just got to go back to listening to the ancestors. What did they tell us? Sing a song. You know, whether we're in the dark times, whether we're in the time period that seems to be in our favor or not. You know why? Because we know that we are more than conquerors. We know that all things work together for the good. And so when we keep that in mind, we say, you know, no matter how difficult a time or period may be, we understand what's going to happen in the end, that it's going to work out. And, you know, this is the craziest thing about life is oftentimes those things that brings us the hardest struggles, the biggest heartaches, those are the things that teaches us the greatest lessons, the biggest lessons,
right,
and then eventually allows us to be what we're supposed to be, that special person inside the world. So whenever we start to look at struggles, I don't look at them as struggles. What I look at them as opportunities and as a representation of what is building me up to do in the future. Because every day it's not going to be sunshine. You know, we talk about New Edition, you know, can you stand the rain? And that's what it's about. Sometimes it's going to rain. But when it rains, you know, just understand, you know, that's a growing season.
But what about when it's raining all the time? Or is that not reality?
That's not reality, because this is the thing. Because if it's raining every day, that means you're alive. So you know that it's raining every day. When you don't know that it's raining,
I want to be mad. I want to be upset.
See, but I think with that, you got to find, and like Dr. Smith is saying, the silver lining in every cloud. Because even the worst days, you can find something good out of them. And I know somebody who recently, their house was burglarized. Their daughter had an unfortunate incident happen to her. But even through all of that, she still managed to say, you know what? This is going to be one of the best family events tomorrow that we've had in a long time, because they got folks coming from out of town. They got friends who changing their plans so it can be one big family unit. So I think finding that silver lining in the cloud is very, very important, because those are the things that get you through the tough times. And like Dr. Smith was saying, we were more than conquerors. So you got to keep that in mind.
No, you know, and it's like when we talk about, you know, people always say, you know, is the glass half empty or is it half full? You know, it's about how you look at it. And the thing is, it's all about our mind, because the mind is so wonderfully powerful. So sometimes when we talk about the power of positive thinking, you know, that's not game that somebody's running. What this is really saying is that, you know, we always talk about neuroplasticity of the brain, as far as the brain can rewire itself, the brain can heal itself, the brain can do things that we didn't even know it could do as far as repairing. And so when we start to think about those hurts and those things that need to be healed, what we do is we let our brain know that, you know what, I'm in control of this vehicle right now. I'm going to turn this wheel. And, yeah, you know, it is a lot of stuff to look at. You cannot look at things and neglect the obvious and say, you know what, I'm not going to look at this and say that this is perfect, this is how I want it. But what I am going to look at this and say, okay, you think this is a crisis, but I'm looking at this as an opportunity.
How can
I overcome? And I tell you, you can look at the saddest event in your life, and then you can look back on it years later and see how you can help somebody else who's going through a tough period of time, or how being in that period of time saved you. You know, we talk about personal experiences. November 23rd, for me personally, is the craziest day of the year for me. My best friend, who I love the most in the world, is my sister, Alicia Moutrie. Today's her birthday.
Oh, wow.
And so, you know, it was always a special day to be able to celebrate somebody who you love, who you care about. But it's also the day that our dad died. Mm-hmm. And I remember, you know, my dad was passing it, and I whispered, I said, man, don't you die on her birthday. Don't you die on her birthday. And he died on her birthday. And I was like, what? How could you do this? Now this day is going to be filled with sadness. And I don't know what the plan was for it, but you know what? Because it is her birthday, I cannot stay, you know, deep in the sorrow.
Right.
But also, when I think about even about my dad, you know, there's an old Dr. Seuss saying. It said, "Don't cry because it's over. Smile because it happened." You know, I'm thankful that I can even think about the memories that we had and all of the things that we did and whatnot like that. So now, instead of letting my mind, you know, think about, "Oh, wow, my dad is not here," what I think about it, say, "I'm grateful that I had a dad. I'm grateful that we were able to spend time together." And he wasn't a perfect dad, but you know, he was my dad, and I loved him. So I take everything that came with it. So even with all of the things that we dealt with growing up, it's about how you look at things in your mind, and you just become extremely grateful. So when we talk about this season specifically, we can get caught up. Excuse me. We can get caught up in thinking about what we don't have, who's not here, how this is not the same from past traditions, and we can get caught up in that and let it become a snowball. Because, like we said, whatever your mind think is the direction it's going to go.
Right.
When we start to put our mind into that positive behavior and say, you know what, whatever somebody tries to throw on me negative, I'm gonna flip the script. You know, you can talk about lemon to lemonades, however you want to put it, but it's about putting a special.
But sometimes
twist
you
on
get
it.
Tired of lemons, you just want the lemonade. Just bring me a glass of lemonade. Why I always got to take the negative and turn it to a positive? I'm seriously. If your whole life just lemons thrown at you, you know, when we go just get a glass of lemonade.
Well, you know, and that's the one thing that I question about somebody saying that all I have is lemons, because now that goes again into our brain, you know, into our mind, our mindset. How do we look at things? Because anybody who can look, and you've lived for a significant period of time, and you can say nothing has happened to me, what I would challenge you to do is to look back at those days, because what you're doing is a disservice to somebody who loved you, who cared for you at some period in time. What we sometimes think is, maybe I didn't get the love from the people who I needed it from the people who I wanted it from. And that's often what happens. It's like we don't get what we want, how we want it, but it's not
right.
That we haven't gotten things. And so what I try to tell people is to look back on those things and those memories. Being a person who's worked in the correctional system for a number of years, this is one place where you could think it would just be a place of torment, specifically during the holidays, because people will have sad stories. You know, we talk about from growing up, from being in foster care or being moved from home to home, or being adopted, not having any real tradition of your own and whatnot like that. But what I found is that those men and women who were locked up at a time that was supposed to be the happiest time of the year, were they sad that they were away and whatnot like that? But even at some period of time, they could sit back and reflect on something that was beautiful and that was great for in their life. Because like most families are going to do tomorrow, you know, you sit around in that ritual and talk about, what am I thankful for? Where it forces you to sit down and say, what am I thankful for? It makes you think of something.
Right.
And these men and these women had the ability to conjure up a lot of stuff where they thought their life was full of these lemons and recognize that it was lemonade there all the time. So sometimes it's not that the lemonade is not there. It's that there are lemons and we focus on the lemons all the time. Nobody's life is perfect. I don't care how much money you have. I don't care how much it looks on the outside. Everybody has issues in life. But what makes most people who are successful is that they can deal with those hard times and they can learn from them. They can grow from them. And even those times that weren't the best, they say, you know what? This wasn't the best for me, but how can I make it better for somebody else? So in this time of the year, we talk about that altruistic type of presence.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the one thing, and I'm going to let my brother talk for a second, because we get a chance, those of us who are blessed, and I'm not just talking about material things, but just blessed in life where we have some of those things where most people would consider lemonade, is to give back. And when you get a chance to give back, seeing the smile on people's faces, seeing everything that's there, man, it's a great feeling. But, man, let me bust out some of my community, too, on the opposite side. So we had Milwaukee Health Services yesterday. And, you know, we giving out turkeys and chicken and food. And they separate. Sometimes they give out turkey. Sometimes they give out chicken. Well, everybody's coming for a turkey. Well, some of the people, if they went in the turkey rotation, they was criticizing. I came here for some turkey. I ain't coming.
Oh, wait a minute.
Chicken.
It was free.
It was free.
Oh, I just wanted to be clear about it. Okay.
Everything was free. Everything was free.
Go ahead. So, proceed. Proceed, as you say.
That's what we had to remind. We say, listen, you know, we know you wanted that turkey, but it ain't the turkey rotation. We apologize that, you know, it wasn't what you wanted, but guess what else you got? Look at all of the other stuff you got and for free. And we say, if you don't want the chicken, give it back. I ain't giving that chicken back. So it was something that was good there, but I'm saying that's just the way that people's mindset can be at times. So it's not that it's always
ungratefulness.
Lemons. Well, yeah, when we talk about an attitude of gratitude, whenever you're getting something for free and you got the audacity to complain, that's when you know I can't even be thankful for things to be thankful for. Now, goodness. You know, in life, we don't always.
But I wanted turkey.
And you know what? That's a reasonable.
I wanted a butterball turkey.
Butterball, to be
it's
exact.
A reasonable complaint. If you think you're coming for turkey and you don't get the turkey, it's a sense of disappointment.
Right.
But it's a difference between being disappointed and being disgruntled to the point where you got attitude, where it's a beautiful thing. We have to remind them, this is a spirit of Thanksgiving. It's the holiday season.
Right.
Be thankful for what you got. I know it ain't what you wanted, but you got something. You want to eat turkey, but guess what? Your belly not going to be hungry. So it just goes again.
And you know, go ahead. I think that speaks to the importance of collectiveness and unity. Because I can remember times being a kid, and Dr. Smith was talking about personal experiences where there were certain things that I wanted for Christmas, and it might have been 7-8 things on that list, but I only got 2. And understanding that, you know what, my folks did whatever they could to get me some of the things that I wanted. And it may have not been the exact name, brand, toy, or whatever, but I still got something. And so I think when we talk about the attitude of gratitude, we have to be thankful for the things that we do get.
Okay. Now, folks who listen to this program, they know that we run a program where we help and support young men and women, young girls who are in out-of-home care, in foster care. And these young folks have faced some serious atrocities in their lives.
Right.
How do we teach that population of children to be thankful, particularly during a time of year when folks are used to being with their family and it makes no difference how healthy or unhealthy that family environment may be? Family is just family.
Still family.
You know, whether you got a chicken or whether you have a turkey or whether you have a hot dog. It's nothing like being with family. So how do you teach children in that predicament, that situation, to be thankful?
And when we're dealing with children, we got to understand, now this is not an adult. We kind of made line okay. the turkey people with mm-hmm. adults who we believe.
But were they acting like kids? Were they acting like kids?
Well, they have a higher level of cognitive ability, so we expect a higher level of thinking.
Right.
But when we deal with children, you know what? What we have to do is this. We have to recognize and be patient, because when you're a child, you do want what you want, and that's when it's a time to be acceptable. So when that person is a little bit more moody, when that person has a little bit more, you know, aggressiveness to their talk, to their behavior, to their walk, that's not saying to be compliant and to let them walk over you, but it's saying you have to be understanding, and what we have to do is spend the time to be able to talk to them, hear what their needs are, see how we might be able to meet some of those needs, and those needs that we cannot meet, it goes back into two different things. One, we start to recreate new memories. We say, you know what?
Right.
This is how it is for this time. And you know what we have to do? We have to kind of normalize it in some ways that what makes most people sad is when we think we're the only one. We're the only one. And when you think about who else is away from their farm, say you're not the only one. This happens. This is normal, because some people think everybody else got this, and so it makes you feel more isolated and individualized. But when you say, you know what? I mean, and I know this from working from a professional sports team. We had to leave on holidays. You know, when you at home, you know, the sports is entertainment, but when you part of the entertainment, you at work, and you away from your family.
Oh, but they getting paid millions. I'll have to see family a little later. Here's that makes a little different, you know.
You left family something before you left, so they should be good.
We're talking about more than time. Right.
See, that's where you're absolutely wrong.
We
see,
had Christmas tomorrow.
See, that's the misperception, because people think, oh, it's the money. People would give up millions of dollars to be able to do that. We have people who are, you know, stationed overseas, you know, protecting the country, and they can't see their families. We have people who,
but is that something that they've chosen? Because foster children, for the most part, didn't choose their predicament. I chose to go into the NBA. I chose to join the military. I'm talking about folks who didn't choose their lot.
Yeah, but
how do they be thankful?
No. Those children of NBA didn't choose to have a dad that went to the NBA. Those children of the armed forces didn't choose to have a mom or dad that went into the, what I'm saying is
that 12-bedroom mansion. No. I'm just saying. They get and they got an attitude. Okay.
And so what I say is this, and most people in professional sports go broke 5 years after they're out of the
contract.
League.
So they're at home all the time.
We think about these big houses and the money they have. Some of that is not as much as you think. It's more of a Trump illusion, if you understand what I'm saying, than really is. But as far as getting back to your questions with the kid, what we have to do is recognize, and we have to be honest with them, say, you know what, it is painful, it is hurtful. You know what, I will sit and cry with a kid. I will sit and let a kid cry to me. But then you know what we're going to do after we cry? We're going to talk about it. We're going to recreate new memories.
There
we're
going to
be grateful for the things that we do have. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at how we can make this situation better for future years. And then, like I said, the last part is altruistic. If it can't be good for me, you know what? Let me quit thinking about I and me. That's the kind of selfish
thought. Right.
Let me get back to a we, because as bad as I think I got it, somebody else has it worse than me. So how can I help somebody else who has it even worse than me? Was something my grandmother always told me. She said, the best way to heal yourself is to help others. So like I said, no matter what situation you're in, I promise you it's always somebody else who's lower. And when you get a chance to give back, it lets you, one, be grateful for saying, wow, you know what, I thought I had it bad, but it's not as bad as I thought it was. But two, I got a chance to help somebody else, which does a lot for the person individually and internally.
Right. And, you know, I really think that's big, because this time of year, and we always try to give our providers a heads up to say, hey, you know what, you got a lot of kids in out-of-home care, and they're not with their families. And because they're not with their families, their emotional mindset can easily go from 0 to 60, 60 to 120, and drop back down to 10. And providers have to be ready and willing to understand that. Because remember, and Dr. Smith mentioned that whole I mentality, I. And a lot of kids have that I mentality. And that's why we have to help them understand that, you know what, sometimes it's not necessarily about you. But even with that, the importance and the value of communication and letting kids know that, you know what, this predicament is not necessarily your fault, but we can get through this together.
But what about parents who give their children everything, and children lack a sense of work ethic or
affluenza?
Affluenza, a sense of entitlement. How do you process and deal with that?
I mean, that's the opposite side of the continuum of this and whatnot like that. And sometimes what that comes from, you have to look at it. I try not to criticize anybody for what they do, because if you grew up poor and you've been put in a position where you do have some financial means, you know what you do? You try to give your children everything you didn't.
Right.
Overcompensate.
And it's overcompensating, but giving them the stuff that you wanted, not understanding the gift of poverty, not being able to have everything, how that instilled in you a work ethic to make sure that you could go, you know, after. And so some parents are able to give their children a lot, but still give them the discipline, the understanding, the teaching that these material things are not everything, and to be appreciative. But when we have a parent who just bestows gifts without the understanding of what it took to get it, and where a person becomes selfish and spoiled, that's when we get the type of traditional American attitude that we have. Because the truth of the matter is just, let's be real. If you're in America, even if you're in a poverty situation, from the rest of the world, you still living like a king.
Mm-hmm.
We suffer from what we call relative deprivation. Right, we say this, you know, all often. I want to repeat it till people can't forget it. Relative deprivation is I'm poor compared to who? I'm poor compared to, but yeah,
you're not third world poor.
If you look at Donald Trump, yeah, you probably will be poor. If you look at what you think NBA, NFL, Major League Baseball players have, yeah, you will be poor. But when you look at what you have, and this is the biggest thing, what we have to start looking at is wealth, and not just monetary ways, but in physical health,
right,
in love, and those things that really matter. And, you know, so when we talk about specifically with our foster children, for those people who might be out of home displacement, whether it's in juvenile correctional facilities, or their parents are sick and they're with relatives, like everything is good, but it was something beyond their control. We had to teach them the importance of love, being grateful and being thankful. And then when you do have this, you also say, you know what, when we do have those good moments, we cannot take them for granted.
Right.
So oftentimes when things are going good, we take them for granted, and it's not, we don't appreciate them until it's gone. So when we talk about living in the moment of now, appreciating it with an attitude of gratitude, no matter what happens to me, you know what, I'm always thankful. Because if it doesn't work out the way I want it to work out, I laugh, because I say, "Woo! I can't wait to see how this is going to work out, because this ain't what I wanted." So I know something else is special for me. It's just how my mind is programmed to think that it's going to work out for me. I was telling my young brothers today, my motto is, I'm an unconquerable champion. And I put in my mind, you know what, I can be defeated, I can lose, but nothing will ever conquer me. So that means no matter what setback ever comes upon me, I know I'm going to overcome this. Why? Because I'm a champion. And once you're a champ, you're always a champ. And so, like I said, talking about mindsets, I invite everybody to create that personal mantra, that personal motto that they need to go back to reinstill in themselves when things aren't going good, how it's going to be okay anyway. It's a lot of us who are in situations that we wish was better, that we wish could be different. So it's not just, you know, we assume sometimes because a person who's in a foster home is worse. But you know what? That the foster home environment that they're in at the moment could actually be better than the family. So it's like we
at that particular time.
At that particular time.
Right.
Okay. And we say, but now how can we build up skills so when we are back in the places that's our natural places to be, how can we make the most of it? How can we make it beautiful? And so what we had to do again is listen to the voices of our children. We don't want to assume things for them. And that's why I said it's so important to talk to them, allow them to really voice everything that they feel and every emotion from happiness to sadness to frustration, and understand that all of the behavior might not be the way we want to. So we got to, like, kind of take a deep breath on some of the things, mm-hmm. and then correct them properly, and then understand, you know what, as I get to know this person a little bit better, maybe I'll be able to reach them and teach them. But if I don't know you and you coming at me hard and it's a difficult time, you're going to get all of the stuff, not that you deserve, but all of the stuff and the pain that I'm feeling. So if we're working with individuals in this case, what we got to do is now have a little bit more patience, have a little bit more mercy, have a right. little bit more temperance. But I said still, not at the not at the risk of reducing the discipline, because we still got to have tough love, but we got to understand how to frame it all together. And we say that as parents, you understand when your kid is having a special extra kind of a day where you say, I'm going to give you a pass, even though I normally would do this. And once it done calmed down, I'm going to talk to you and tell you why this will not happen again. But again, like I said, for our individuals who might not be in a place that we think is the best, that's where it's so important for the rest of us in the community. So if we know somebody who's in a place that they're not supposed to be, why don't we do something extra? Why don't we get off of our couch? You know, instead of watching that third football game, instead of having that fourth helping and whatnot, go do something for somebody else.
Make
their day something special. You know, we always talk on this radio, you know, it's like, well, what can we do? What can be done? Well, this is one of those small things that can be done. Mm-hmm. When you just give a little bit of yourself, you don't have to give even the whole day. But if you come, you know, I always knew it was Christmas time. My mom would play, you know, this one song called Give Love on Christmas Day.
And
everybody know that, you know, when we talk about the Temptation, they know that song, they know mm-hmm. that. And when I think about the holidays, that's the spirit about what are we really giving, not what are we receiving. And if we know somebody is lacking, what are we doing specifically to help them?
And, you know, before, Jermaine, before you respond, and I think for all our listeners out there, so a couple things that I've heard, and anybody can correct me if I'm wrong. One is communication, having open communication with our young people. Two, patience and understanding, because we all come from different experiences and sometimes we may not see the things the same way. So having that understanding will go a long way. And next, discipline, making sure that we keep discipline in place in a certain level of structure, because kids are learning. So they're going to bump and they're going to test boundaries. So we have to always keep that in mind.
Well, another thing that I've heard is that happiness is a choice.
Mm.
That we can find happiness, we can find some element of contentment in regards to what circumstance we're in. No matter how negative it may appear, there is some good in everything. All of it may not be good, but there is some good, and it's up to us to identify what that good is and to look at these obstacles as opportunities.
Right. And, you know, that's powerful because if we focus on the wrong things, because everything has, if you look at a timeline, and if you're in the moment of something, everything has a positive aspect and a negative aspect to it. Unfortunately, this year alone, I've been to 9 funerals, family, friends, different folks. And one of the things that kind of helped me cope, because coping is critical to everything that we do in life, one of the things that helped me cope through all of these losses is finding valuable memories that I had with those individuals, and two, appreciating all of the folks who came together for this individual's event.
So children who are in foster care can reflect on those positive memories Absolutely. That they had with their families
Absolutely.
To help them get through
the tough times.
The tough time.
Okay. Yeah.
That sounds really good. You know, and you know, I guess when I look at the model of care in foster care, if you will, mm-hmm. the model of care is one that promotes giving folks things, you know, whatever the foster child wants, give it to them, But how do you counter and you balance that as a foster parent when you're trying to teach maybe a work ethic or an attitude of gratitude that maybe you need to work towards something and nobody in life is just going to give you anything?
Yeah.
And then part of the reality is that if we place you in a home environment where an individual receives compensation from a public entity to support you, if you transition or reunify with your family of origin and their economic state is not the same as the foster home that you were in and you're used to getting stuff, it seems to me like that can create some
major friction,
unhappiness.
Unhappiness.
Well, the first thing is, I disagree with as far as the giving, sure. giving in the beginning.
Yeah.
I think we need to give them those things that they need.
Yes.
And then what we have to do is also give those things that they need. Well, you said that's the same thing. No, we have to give them those things that they need, shelter, food, care, those things
and
of that nature. But we also have to give them the things they need as far as the concept of we, the concept of giving back. So when I give so that I can give back. And, I'm going to give you and your staff, big props because over with the young men that you work with over at Fresh Start, they were able to come over to Milwaukee Health Services yesterday, too. So it's like once you get a lot, if you understand, I'm blessed so I can be a blessing. So those are those same lessons we have to teach. And also when we talk about how do we reintegrate back into the home, what we have to do is let people know. And, I tell my kids this because it's like once they leave my house, their life is going to be different once they go to college or once they get their own, house or whatnot like that. They're going to have to reduce it. So we try to teach that it's not about, the economic gain. It's not about the materialism. It's about love because at the end of the day, I don't care how rich you are. If you don't have your health or you by yourself, you trade all those things in for everything. So when we talk about giving them what we need, what we have to do is instill in them is, Sister Herrera says this all the time. The first gift I think we can give children is the knowledge of self, teaching them to understand who they are so they can not only know who they are, accept who they are, love who they are. Because once you can accept yourself and once you know who you are and you can truly love yourself, then you can honestly give that love back. So many reasons why our foster children, why so many of our children who are still in their homes of origin are frustrated and upset is because of that lack of knowledge of self, which leads to a lack of love. And you can only give out what's in you.
That's right.
All right. We're going to take a break on Fresh Start today. We'll be right back on the other side. Thank you all for tuning in. Stay tuned.
This is Jermaine reporting from Fresh Start's WBCM, Wisconsin Black Children Matter. Did you know that the number of black children in Milwaukee's foster care community continues to rise? According to the Department of Children and Families' most recent annual report, black children made up 68.2% of Milwaukee's foster kids. Many of these children are not only removed from their family and siblings, but are placed in families and communities that do not reflect or honor their race, culture, or heritage. Fresh Start is an agency that is committed to serving and advocating for black children. In order to meet the needs of this growing population, we need more black families in the Milwaukee area that love and celebrate black children. To become a licensed, culturally responsive foster parent with Fresh Start, you must be 21 years old, married or single with a stable income, clear several criminal background checks, and complete 36 hours of pre-licensing training. To learn more about other qualifications, call 414-351-1100. That's 414-351-1100. Again, this is Jermaine reporting from Fresh Start, WBCM, Wisconsin Black Children Matter.
Good afternoon. You're listening to Fresh Start today with Jermaine and Sean Roby. We have Dr. Ramell Smith. We have somebody on the line. Thank you, caller, for tuning in to the show. Happy holidays. Caller? I'm sorry, we've lost our caller. But we were talking about the attitude of gratitude and, just some things that we can teach our kids, some tangible things. You had brought up the wonderful event that the Milwaukee Health Services did yesterday with giving away holiday dinners. And some people wanted turkeys, other folks wanted chicken, and there was a system that was in place. And the folks who organized that, we give a shout-out to Pam Clark over there, Pamela Clark. MHS, they were really just trying to do a really good deed for the community, and they still couldn't satisfy everybody. And it's unfortunate because you're talking about modeling, gratefulness and thankfulness. And the young men who are part of our program who went to help volunteer, 13 and 14 and 17-year-old, they brought that issue up later in the day, in the evening time, in terms of how grown folks were acting. So it speaks volumes how important our behavior is.
Yes.
'Cause children are always watching.
I mean, that's what we talk about when we talk about social learning. You know, how do I learn how to behave? How do I learn how to act? So it's like it's our responsibility as a community, because you never know who's looking. You know, and it's like you said, especially in a time like that. So it gives somebody else. Now I have the ability. Oh, I saw that's how this person is. This gives me a license to act like that, too,
right?
Because especially if it's an adult and I've been trained to look at adults and respect adults. Well, you know what? That's what I want to do. And if I already got a little, you know, chip on my shoulder, I'm going to look at that adult and I'm going to look at the adult who handled it the right way. But I'm going to side with the person who handled it the way I want to and use that as my example, use that as my excuse.
Mm-hmm.
So when we start talking about, you know, what we're doing, you know, we definitely, we don't want to be fake. You know, we want to be real with our emotions, be real with our feelings. But we got to understand that there are many people who are looking. But also, I mean, that's whenever we talk about, you know, what true character is. True character is what you do when you don't think anybody is looking. So even if a child isn't looking, we should be doing, you know, the right thing anyway. And one of the things that I teach is like, because none of us in here are perfect. All of us have had some opportunity where somebody can look at us and say, hey, you didn't perform this way. You didn't do this at that time. And then the mm-hmm. question is, okay, but did I learn from it? And how did I learn from it? And how am I correcting it for the future? And so for all of the people, like I said, if you've been having an attitude of non-gratitude, this is the time to flip it. You know, this is a time of Thanksgiving. You know, tomorrow especially, you know, we gonna get to eat some good food. You know, we gonna get a couple of the drinks out. You
but
know,
I want turkey. I want chicken. I want turkey.
Yeah. Hey, but you know what? It's the same thing, because it's gonna be somebody at the family house and somebody gonna get the last of the macaroni and cheese. And
that corner.
You ain't even eating all that. And your kids don't ever eat all that. They just waste over. Why you get them take all that? What we got to understand is this. You know what? If you got a family, you're already blessed. If you got multiple people who's at the house, because it's somebody who's going to cook a whole lot of food, not going to have anybody there to eat it with, and that's going to make them sad, too. So it's always something that we can be, you know, frustrated about, sad about. Okay. What we had to do is look, like I said, you know, at our situation and going to what you say. You know, happy is conditional. It's going to be some times that we're not happy. But, you
right.
know, joy is something that can't be taken away, something that can't be stolen unless you, you know, give it away. So I stay, you know, everything doesn't make me happy, but I'm going to stay joyful. I'm going to stay optimistic about what's going to happen, and I'm going to stay grateful. You know, even in the midst, and I think all of us in here can account of some times where we've been on hard times. It's been something difficult or frustrating. But we overcame it. So that's the time to think about, you know, being thankful. You know, we talk about, you know, all of the stuff that's going to happen. I think the biggest thing what we want to do is say we're going to have some special things happen tomorrow. Let's not let certain things interrupt those things. And what do I mean by that? We talk about people going to drink. All right, you can have a couple of sips, but you ain't got to drink the whole bottle, because we know what happened when you drink the whole bottle. That's when a beautiful family event turns into, you know, okay, there go your cousins and them over there tripping and acting up again. That's going
And children are watching.
Uh-huh.
Right.
And so when we start talking about, you know, everything that we do, even with the eating, you know, you want to be careful. You don't want to overeat. And it's not just about stuffing ourselves because it's fun, but I'm talking about the aftermath of then that becoming a roller coaster for binge eating for the next couple of days in the holiday season. And then we're grossly overweight with those Wisconsin winter bodies, and then we're frustrated and sad and looking at ourselves at that time. And then, you know, also, you know, I'm down with my brother William Muhammad. You know, he said up with Jesus and down with Santa as far as the spending. But some of y'all gonna go out to Black Friday tomorrow and spend. So I tell you, be real careful, because you're gonna hurt your pocketbooks. And if you are gonna go spend it, like I said, I'm like brother Muhammad. I'm saying, hey, spend with somebody who got pigmentation like you. Let's support our own during this time. I'm down with redistributing the pain. That's Ramell Smith, not Jermaine Reed, a fresh starter, Brother Sean. But it's like about how do we make, you know, a difference. When we start talking about all of this stuff from an attitude to gratitude, it comes to this now reactivating ourselves. You talked about in the beginning, you know, all of the stuff with the political wars and foster cares. What if instead of helping young people with foster care, we did some stuff to eliminate the need for foster care? And, you know, it's not utopian in a sense, but
right,
say,
right.
Why don't we eradicate the need to have foster parents? And those are things that's not going to happen
right.
overnight, but to put inside our mind instead of, you know, being reactive and trying to solve a problem that's already, just dealing with the problem. Why don't we do something proactively to truly solve the problem?
Dr. Ramell Smith, somewhere tonight, whether it's here in the city of Milwaukee or in some other community, some parent's child is going to be removed from them today. I promise you. I promise you. How do we help that parent or those parents whose children have been removed this week? How do we help them?
Yeah, you know what? I mean, that's a tough one, because it's like whenever something happens initially, it's a fresh wound. So the main thing what you can do is just to be there for them.
Right.
You know, what they need you to do for them is to be there, because you can't fill that hole. You know, if somebody take your kid away, I mean, that's one of the most painful feelings in the world. And the initial pain, the initial shock, and then for it to be, you know, compounded with being a beautiful holiday where we are supposed to be grateful, we are supposed to be thankful, it hurts. So, you know, we don't have any magic bullets. We don't have anything that's a panacea that's going to cure it. But it's just like, you know, I look at it like a minor death. What would you do if somebody passed away? You try to be there for them in any way that you can. You listen to them. You talk to them. Any way that you can help, you help. But you also have to calm them down, because at that time, somebody might want to make a bad decision that could have further negative ramifications. So sometimes we have to be there to help people, not right. to hurt themselves.
So I appreciate you saying that, because I think it was a couple Christmases ago, 2 years ago, I had some children in my care whose parent had actually murdered some folks. And they came to me on Christmas Eve, and I didn't have no Christmas tree up. I didn't have no gifts, you know, but it was a different type of Christmas. And so I know what the holiday can do to folks who are involved with the system, whether we're talking about the parents or we're talking about children, and being able to give folks some tangible tips, whether we're talking about foster parents or whether we're talking about biological relatives.
Right.
How do we support these folks? Because some people will not be able to see their children this holiday. Typically in foster care, there has to be some type of approval process or clearance that is given in order for a child to go back home and spend the holiday with mom or dad, depending on what the issues have been for removal and how cooperative folks have been with services over a period of time would determine whether or not the powers, quote unquote, that be will allow those children to go back home. But when children do go back home, you know, going back into that environment, you would think that it would evoke some positive, happy, joyous feelings. But what happens when the opposite occurs? And then for those foster parents who need to go pick the kid back up or to bring them back into the foster care setting, what can they do to have a more smoother or sensitive transition?
Well, you're talking about a rebound from a honeymoon. And so while those paperworks are being submitted, and the foster care provider would understand this and know this, what we have to do is be proactive. We have to talk to them. And what I say is always, I hope to be prepared. I hope for the best, but I'm prepared for the worst.
Right.
And so the foster parent must talk to the foster child about all of the different emotions they possibly can experience, all of the different options that's available to them. And like I said, it's a rebound from the honeymoon, because to be reunited with your family is something special. But also there's a reason why a person was taken away, and that's going to bring up some other different pain, some different frustration.
Right.
So like we spoke earlier, you know, we talk about the art of forgiveness, that understanding that everything that happened, you may not forgive right away. It may be some hurt wounds and whatnot, but how do we start to deal with it? And this is one of those steps. And when we start talking about coming back, we as foster parents and those who provide for children also have to understand that maybe with some bad things that happened that reignited while they were gone, and the realization that, man, they might not go back, so you're going to get some different negative behavior. Or maybe it was so great, they don't understand why they have to come back home, and so you're getting a different child that's coming back.
Yeah.
And so we just have to be ready, and we have to kind of brace. We have to put that shield on. The holidays is always going to be an extreme of emotions. You know, you're going to get the highest of highs and the lowest of lows. And what we have to do is, like I said, try to prepare our children as much as we can cognitively to their emotional level of understanding at the time, but also for us as adults to understand those things, because it's not an easy process. But if we understand it's not an easy process going on, we gird ourselves as much as possible going forward, so we understood what we could be getting into. When it happens, we're not as shocked, and we're forearmed, we're forewarned, so we're forearmed.
And I think to add to that, when you talk about the list we mentioned before, providers have to have, or foster parents, however you want to frame it, need to have a certain level of patience and understanding, because if you've never been in that predicament, you don't understand the emotional repercussions that can come from that.
Because sometimes children in the foster home environment, those individuals can be having a very happy, joyous time, and just being there saying grandma and granddaddy and
folks,
you know, to see this family enjoying their holiday, but I'm not with my family.
There you go.
And so then you wonder where the acting out can come from or triggers, you know. Mm-hmm. And then you have folks that, well, I don't want them kids coming up here because they go tear up, they go spoil our holiday, you know. But I think we have to be empathetic and understanding,
and you
know, what's going on with those children and how do we support those children through these holiday seasons.
And that's what I said, it's so important to talk because, you know, sometimes we could think we've given somebody everything, and that's where we get into that point of I and thinking, like, I did this and I did this. How could they be so ungrateful? How could they be so unthankful? But if this is not your family, your biological family,
right,
you can still feel like an outsider, even though everybody's done everything possibly to do to include you. What we had to do is understand that everybody is at different spots, and we have to be considerate. That's a great point, Sean.
Yeah, and, you know, another part with that in terms of helping foster parents and with the youth they work with in that transition is that whole concept of share parenting. And if it's possible for the biological and foster family to work on one accord, that can really go pretty far because then the parent can be talking to, or both parents can be talking to each other when the child is in one environment or the other. They can have different additional visitations going on outside of the formal one. So all of those little things can work to better equip that biological family, especially when the plan is for that child to return home.
Well, you know what? This has certainly been a great conversation around the attitude of gratitude, and I'm certain that folks are thankful for something. Now, you know what I'm thankful for?
What?
I don't know. I know I'm tired of these lemons, but I get no turkey either. But, you know, black man can't get nothing around this piece. But listen, one thing I'm thankful for is that tomorrow I'll be gathering the tribe together, all of them, the Mohicans. They coming together.
There you go.
And at some point in the time, I'm going to be taking some kids who are not with their parents legally and taking them into their family environment so that they, too, can spend the holiday with them. So that's what I'm thankful and I'm grateful. What you thankful for, Dr. Smith?
You know what, man? I'm thankful for my wife, Stacy. I'm thankful for my kids, Joy, Jonah, Noah, Sky. Thankful for my extended family, for my mother, for my in-laws, for my sisters, nephews, all my cousins. We're going to meet over at my Aunt Sue's tomorrow, and we're going to have, you know, some banana pudding, some dressing, some turkey, some
going
ham,
down,
some meatballs, potato salad, coleslaw. Some,
I thought I was
some,
in the family.
Some corn. Some,
am I one of the relatives y'all don't want to acknowledge?
You know, and it's funny because they've been on Facebook, everybody posting what they're going to bring and showing, you know, parts of it. And, you know, it's just what I call a cornucopia or a smorgasbord of love, you know, what it's all about.
Love.
You
and
name
so that's,
it.
That's what you name it. We got hogs, more
grass, beans, chicken,
beans. You name it.
Now, you know we got some friends that listen to the program. What are they talking about?
Well, I don't understand.
Hog moths.
Well, what do you mean?
Listen, what are you, Pierre? What are you thankful
Brother
for?
I'm thankful just to have another day on Earth to be thankful.
Oh,
wow. See, that's what I'm
deep.
Talking about.
See that? Love see, y'all get real deep on somebody. You know, just glad to be on Earth. I can deal with anything else.
Ain't no limits in this life.
And you know what? And that's a real, that's a beautiful concept because if you, and like Dr. Smith was saying earlier, if you have particular mantras that you talk and tell yourself every single day, it blocks the rain. It blocks all the extra heat and whatnot. So you can be thankful for more.
Some shade.
Some shade. But you know what? Me, myself, I'm thankful for all of you brothers in here because if you look around, it's all men in here. This many black men in one event, and we're all talking about something useful, helpful,
and number seven,
and powerful.
That ain't a whole lot. We're gonna.
I'm also thankful for my family and friends and all of my loved ones. I love you all unconditionally, rain, sleet, hail, or snow. Thank you.
All right. How you doing, Keon? What you thankful for today?
I'm thankful for God and the position he's put me in to be able to touch so many lives in a moment's time. The platform he's given me to allow voice to the unheard. So every day above ground, baby.
Well, listen, family, I hope you all enjoy the holiday season. And, you know, what I don't like about the holiday season is that for whatever reasons, we have a tendency to allow things to leak and not to hold on to it. And so then we create this, what I say, this pseudo environment and spirit of joy and happiness from Thanksgiving to Christmas. And then January 25th, we go right back into a slump. Let's not go there. Let's make happiness a lifestyle. Let's make gratitude a mindset and a lifestyle, not just for the moment, but yes, to be thankful every day, to reach out and serve our community, to help our fellow man, to take care of ourselves. Collective, the Ubuntu you talked
That's
about.
Right. Yes,
so listen, we love you all here, and we'll be back next week. You all be well, be safe, and don't eat too much.